Welcome, everyone. My name is Kiki Akosi, and I'm very happy to be your president this year. It is my honor to introduce to you Dr. Jay Sanders, President and CEO of the Global Telemedicine Group, and adjunct professor of medicine at Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine. His activities have included servicing on the NASA Biological and Physical Research Advisory Committee, acting as a consultant to the NASA Space Communications Center, and serving as the science director for the NASA Medical Information and Technology Applications Commercial Space Center. He was a member of the Department of Defense Telemedicine Board of Directors with the Surgeon Generals of the Army, Navy, and Air Force. And during the Clinton administration, he directed the U.S. telemedicine initiatives for the G8 nations. Dr. Jay Sanders.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. It's actually not only a privilege to be here, it is sort of really, really nice to be back at the National Science Foundation. As a matter of fact, if it were not for the National Science Foundation, I wouldn't be here today from a figurative standpoint, not a literal standpoint, because it was in 1973 that I received my first grant from the National Science Foundation to do something that nobody had ever heard of before called telemedicine. With that said, I suspect half of the people in this audience still don't know what in the world telemedicine is. But, you know, I'm really not going to spend a lot of time talking about telemedicine. Telemedicine is not important. What is important is what the problems are in the healthcare delivery system and how this technology, and today this technology is not disruptive. It was disruptive in the early 1970s. We had to build it all. Now all the technology that I will talk about is all off-the-shelf technology. What will be, I hope, somewhat disruptive to you are the applications that we are going to describe for this type of technology. I want to apologize in advance, and that is that I hope to make you, after this talk, feel very uncomfortable about your health. I did not do a survey of how many of you had dessert for lunch. But the group that should feel most concerned after my talk are all of those in the audience who have been told or feel they are normal. Those of you who have been taking medication over the lunch times, who know you were sick, you're okay. I also forgot this morning, much to my chagrin as I opened the folder for today's talk, that someone had titled it, I don't recall my titling it, The Electronic Patient, so I quickly threw up this slide of an electronic patient. We'll actually talk a little bit about this. I'd like to start here. Where are we, and where do we need to go? And for any look in the future, one always has to start in the past. And I hope you take a good look at this slide. This is the picture that appeared on the front cover of a magazine called Radio News, within the upper right-hand corner, in April of 1924. By the way, this magazine still exists. It just changed its name. It's called Popular Mechanics. What does it show? It shows a young boy sitting on the edge of his bed at home with a sore throat, showing his sore throat to his physician, who was where? He's at his office. Now remember, in those days, a house call, a physical house call by a physician was routine. Somebody thought of changing this to what we didn't call telemedicine until the late 1960s. Now, Who thought of this? Take a look at the editor. It's H. Gernsback. There has to be a science fiction buff in the room who knows what the H stands for.
Hugo.
Hugo.
Exactly. And as you know, the Hugo Awards come out every year. They're just like the Oscars and the Emmys in science fiction writing. And Hugo Gernsback, who was the editor of this, thought of this. The fascinating thing about this is if you were just starting up a company today and wanted to figure out how to deliver care at a distance, this should be your blueprint. Because of the following reason. What was the device they were using to bring healthcare into the home? The only device it could have been, 1924, a radio. TV was not available. It was just being thought of in those days. There was no working model of TV. So the idea to me, if you're going to introduce new technology, make the technology as transparent as possible. Make it as intuitive as possible. So if you're going to deliver care at home electronically, use a device that the consumer can easily adapt to. A radio. And what does a radio have in terms of its controls? It has two knobs, an on and off switch, and you can increase the volume. And if you want to see a different specialist, you just take the tuning knob and you just turn it. And what about the communication infrastructure? It's a radio. Everybody's got a radio. The system is totally embedded. The nice thing about it also, because everybody always asks this question, well, this may be great, but you know, people are going to feel funny about seeing their doctor at a distance. Look at the little boy's two friends. They're fascinated by the use of this technology. And I have to tell you, and I'll say it again when I get to that slide, and I don't mean to sound like a chauvinist, but when we see elderly women at home with the technology that I will show you, it is the most important social event of their day. They get dressed up, they put on makeup, and they think they are on TV. All of the scientific studies that have been done to assess the psychological impact of this has demonstrated overwhelming 95% and higher receptivity on the part of the patient to having care delivered in this manner. There are going to be four critical messages that I want to leave with you today. By the way, the latest legislation that we have, and I approve of some of the things in it, doesn't address any of the real problems in our healthcare delivery system today, I'm sorry to say. It almost follows our approach to dealing with, almost follows Winston Churchill's comment, you know, that great, not only a great statesman, a great social philosopher, but remember, and I'm old enough to remember, after the Second World War, he was interviewed by a number of reporters, and he was asked why he liked America so much. I'm sure a number of you remember that quote. And he said, well, you've got to love America. He said, whenever they have a problem, they always come up with the right solution to that problem after they've tried everything else. I'm going to show you why we need to bring the exam room to the patient. And I'm going to start with the reason that the National Science Foundation gave me a grant in 1973. And we spent 3 years doing that. Very successful outcome. And for the next 15 years, I was going around the country proselytizing everybody. Look at our results. Why aren't we doing this? And everybody thought I was crazy. And what they probably didn't realize was is, yeah, I was probably a little crazy, but I was also very stubborn, and I was going to keep talking about it. Well, this is what you would see as old technology. This is circa 1991, when after the completion of our National Science Foundation grant on telemedicine to address geographic isolation of patients in this country, i.e. the same problem we have, unfortunately, still today in our rural communities, and at the request of the then governor of the state of Georgia, Governor Zell Miller, this isn't being recorded, right? He and the president of the Medical College of Georgia called me and said, we want to set up a statewide telemedicine program in the state of Georgia. And I remember the first time I met Governor Miller, and he said to me, Dr. Sanders, I need to tell you, I happen to be the governor of two states. And I looked at him somewhat quizzically, and I said, I don't understand, Governor. He said, yes, I am the governor of Atlanta and the governor of the rest of Georgia. And he pointed out to me, he said, look, yes, we need healthcare delivery, but it's not simply bringing healthcare to the rest of Georgia outside of Atlanta where we have everything that we need, and we don't have all this expertise in the rest of Georgia. It is not simply a healthcare issue, it is a socioeconomic issue. And that was my first lesson, Economics 101, and it was actually very prophetic. I said, I didn't understand what you meant about the economic issue. And you don't know, his next comment was something that was prophetic. He said, well, Jay, what do you think would happen if I closed all the automobile factories in Detroit? That was 1991 when he said this to me. He said, what do you think would happen to the economy in Detroit? I said, well, I understand. I said, but what does that have to do with these rural communities? He said, think about who is the number one employer or the number two employer in these rural communities. It's the rural hospital. And the reason they wanted me to come up was to try and sustain the rural hospital. And I knew at the time that in the United States, 10 to 12 rural hospitals per month were going under. They were closing. Why were they closing? Was it because managed health care had come into their community or driving down hospital bed utilization? Absolutely not. The thing that was driving down hospital bed utilization was the fact that if you had a cardiological problem, or you had a neurological problem, or you got in an automobile accident, you couldn't go to the rural hospital. They didn't have the expertise there. Most rural hospital medical staff are made up of primary care docs, family practitioners, an occasional internist, maybe a general surgeon. But if you had a neurological problem, there was no neurologist. What would happen? You would be either discharged from that facility and sent to the secondary or tertiary care facility, or what a lot of people in the community did, they immediately knew that the local hospital didn't have the expertise to take care of them. They immediately bypassed that hospital. And rural hospitals were going under. So Governor Miller wanted a system that would be able to retain the patient in the rural hospital, stabilize their bed census, keep them in business, and sustain the socioeconomic fabric of that community. And in fact, if you did the research in the early 90s, you found that when a rural hospital went under, within a 3 to 5 year period of time, the entire socioeconomic fabric of that community went under. So this was a healthcare and this was an economic issue. So we did basically what we did back in 1973. Under the NSF grant, we set up a statewide telemedicine network. And the statewide network consisted of 3 academic medical centers, connected to 9 comprehensive secondary care hospitals, each of which in turn were connected to 4 primary care facilities, a rural hospital, a correctional facility, a school, a freestanding clinic. It depended upon the geography and the needs at each location within the state, and the entire system was networked together. We had 59 sites. And look at what the system was. We used what was then the state-of-the-art video conferencing equipment, and we realized that we needed to have something more than just a see-me, talk-to-me kind of system. We needed diagnostic capability. So we developed, I was also a senior scientist, I was professor of medicine and surgery. By the way, forget the surgery part, I'm an internist, don't ever let me operate. But for some reason, I had that title. I was also senior research scientist in the biomedical engineering division at Georgia Tech. And we developed an electronic stethoscope, an electronic otoscope, an ophthalmoscope, and gastroscope, and colonoscope. And let me tell you, the best way to ever do a colonoscopy is when you're 100 miles away from the patient. And we put the system into place. And here on the left-hand side is our cardiologist at the Medical College of Georgia examining a patient 130 miles away in Eastman, Georgia. It doesn't matter whether it's 130 miles or 13,000 miles away. It does matter if we're operating on Mars because of the latency. I'll get into that in a little bit. But the fundamental reality is my cardiologist in Augusta, Georgia, was examining a patient 130 miles away. Very simply, the telecommunications, standard, everyday telecommunications infrastructure using the electronic stethoscope. And we could zoom in if we wanted to look at a skin rash. We could zoom in also on the chest x-ray, review the chest x-ray or an ultrasound that might have been done. And here, the primary care physician at the distant hospital is listening to her patient's heart at the same time the specialist back at the academic medical center is doing that. This brings immediate access to specialty care for any and every patient who might find themselves geographically isolated from that expertise. And today, probably one of the best examples of its use, where it is fundamentally a matter of life and death, is as an example in the case of if you were today driving through a rural community, say in Virginia, and suddenly had a stroke, and you were taken immediately to the rural hospital emergency department. If within a 3 to 4.5 hour window, you could be seen by a neurologist, and that neurologist was able to identify that your stroke was related to a clot, not an embolus, but a clot, and the majority of strokes are related to a clot in a vessel. They would give you a medication called plasminogen activator, TPA, and that medicine would dissolve the clot and you would literally walk out of that ER. If you're not seen within that period of time, you are admitted to the hospital with a stroke, you're paralyzed, and what often happens, you die. A simple medication intravenously that lyses the clot, if it's given within the certain golden window of opportunity, you go from being dead to being alive. And the irony of this is that most rural hospitals have no neurologists. So who's going to evaluate you? Who's going to look at that CAT scan? Who's going to do the neurological examination and be able to say, look, this is a clot, not an embolus, or not a hemorrhage. If it's a hemorrhage, you don't want to give a substance that causes further bleeding. One of the biggest applications today in rural America is IntelliStroke Care. One of the fascinating things about this, that very few of us who are doing this on a worldwide basis really think about or talk enough about, is obviously the initial knee-jerk reaction is, gee, what a wonderful thing we're doing for the patient. But it turns out we're also doing a wonderful thing for that primary care physician. We have actually found through studies since the 70s that over a period of time, if you have a successful telemedicine program, the actual number of consultative requests over a period of time go down. You may be saying, well, wait a minute, what are you talking about? Well, that primary care physician listening to that murmur, while the cardiologist is listening to the murmur, and the cardiologist is saying, oh, listen, did you hear that mid-systolic click? By the way, turn the patient over a little bit on their left side. Did you hear the accentuation of that click? Over a period of time, that primary care physician's educational level goes up. Next time a patient with that condition comes in, they know how to take care of it now. They don't have to ask for the consultant. So we're not only improving the care of the patient, we're improving the educational level of the physician in that rural site. Now, one of the obvious reasons for doing this was, clearly, so we didn't have to take the patient who was in congestive heart failure and pulmonary edema coming into the rural hospital ER and transport that very tenuous sick patient to an academic medical center. And then it dawned on me in 1992, after we had set the system up, gee, remember that slide, radio news slide? Why in the world am I waiting for the patient to get sick enough to have to come into whatever ER, whether it's an urban-based ER or a rural-based ER? What if I could actually examine that patient in their home? If I had seen the patient with congestive heart failure 4 or 5 days prior to their ending up in the ER with florid pulmonary edema and having to be intubated and sent to the intensive care unit, what if I noticed that their weight was going up, the primary event that occurs in a patient with congestive heart failure, their renal perfusion goes down, so they don't excrete as much urine, which causes their weight to go up. It's the first signal that I know they're going into congestive heart failure. All I need is a scale. Why don't I start trying to examine these patients at home? So, we did. We're working with Georgia Tech and getting, pardon the expression, an earmark from the federal government, we developed that radio news telehome care technology. We were just a little late. Somebody else had the idea, Hugo Gernsback, which always proves to me, and I should have admitted right from the beginning, but I wanted to capture you first before you ran running out of the room, that I am a Trekkie. And I do believe all those things will happen. I know there is some, at least by our present physics, there are some things like transportation we can't do, at least by our present ignorance. Fundamentally, why don't I take the science fiction of Hugo Gernsback and convert it into science? To me, the only difference between science fiction and science is time. So we did it, and we wanted to use an intuitive, we learned our lesson in looking at that slide, we wanted to use an intuitive technology. What did we use? We used the person's TV. And you might be asking, how did we get two-way interactivity? This was 1992. All that existed in the cable system was coaxial cable. Well, it turns out if you talk to the communication folks, they actually came to us, the local cable provider came to us and said, we want to be part of this. All you do is take a reverse amplifier, take it through an Ethernet bridge, and you now have two-way interactive connectivity on your TV. And we added a few medical devices, and we were able to examine our patients at home. And then the epiphany occurred. we found out we not only could examine our patient at home, we had to examine our patient at home. Let me tell you why. Let's imagine that Mrs. Jones here has asthma. And Mrs. Jones is our classical asthma patient. In the winter time, she is readmitted to the hospital literally every 2 to 3 weeks in what is called status asthmaticus. She has to be intubated, has to be sent to the intensive care unit. 3 weeks before, we had just discharged her. Her pulmonary function studies were totally normal. She was on all the right medications. What in the world happened in those next 2 to 3 weeks at home? Why is this a revolving door pattern? Well, we started to see Mrs. Jones at home. And she's now interacting with us at the office. And what do we see for the first time? Well, Mrs. Jones is sitting on this great big puffy chair with these somewhat not clean doilies. And there's a thick rug on the floor. And there are thick curtains on the window. And she's telling me her history as she's petting her cat in her lap. And her husband is standing at the kitchen door, fascinated by this whole thing, smoking a cigarette. For those of you who are not immunologists, Mrs. Jones is living in an explosive, antigenic environment. She doesn't need any more corticosteroids. She needs an interior decorator, and somebody needs to tell her she's living with a man who wants to kill her. This is the most ridiculous thing in the world. As we began to examine our patients at home, it turned out that our patient with hypertension, the values of the blood pressure we were getting at home were so much better than the values we were getting in the office. Have you all heard of white coat hypertension? Do you realize that 1/3 of the people in this country who are diagnosed with hypertension on therapy have normal blood pressures? Their blood pressures just go up in the doctor's office. They get a sympathetic overdrive because they see the doctor coming at them with a blood pressure cuff. They're worried because they're about to get their insurance physical next week, or for whatever other reason, and their blood pressure goes up. The other 23 hours and 45 minutes of the day, they're normal. Taking a child's peak expiratory flow rate, a child with asthma, taking their pulmonary functions in my office is the most ridiculous thing in the world. They're not breathing the air in my office. The antigens they're responding to are the antigens in their home, in their school. That's where it needs to be taken. So what we learned was not that we could do it. We have to bring, in the majority of situations, we need to bring the exam room to where the patient is, not where the doctor is. If we do it at home, we can do it any place we want. So as a matter of fact, under a NASA grant in 1999, we developed the first telemedicine kiosk. And today we can do it over the internet. This is RP7. I tried to get, this is a company called InTouch Health, in this beautiful place called Santa Barbara, California. That's where I want to start my company. And this is, they call it a telemedicine robot. It's really a glorified video conferencing machine sitting on top of an internet-based, wirelessly controlled robot. So if I'm in Abu Dhabi today, and I still have a couple of patients in the intensive care unit at Hopkins, I can make rounds on them over the internet with my laptop. And that's what's being done every single day. And as a matter of fact, this type of robot, along with other types of video conferencing telemedicine devices, are now being deployed in many, many ERs to address the telestroke type of situation. We still have some privacy security problems.
No.
We'll work through those. Okay, folks, let me warn you, this is the scary part. For those of you who think you're normal. There are no standards, folks, in the healthcare delivery system. I hate to break that to you, but there are absolutely no standards. Let me prove it to all of you right now. If you don't mind, we'll do a little childish thing. Just raise your hand. How many of you have had a physical exam? Great, great. Keep your hands up. Keep your hands up a second. How many during the physical exam had the doctor listen to their heart and lung sounds? Great, every hand. Good. Now, keep your hands up. How many of you, before the doctor listened to your heart and lung sounds, asked your physician when they had their last hearing test? You, John, you too. More importantly, did you ever ask him what's between his ears?
A license.
Those of you who've been told, oh, I hear a murmur, we're going to get further testing, you're safe. What about those of you who walked out of the office with a big smile on your face? Oh, the exam was totally normal, the doctor told me the heart and lungs were fine. How in the world do you know he even heard it? By the way, when I was a young faculty member, if you had a very soft mitral murmur, floppy mitral valve, I could hear it. You better have a grade 6 murmur today for me to hear it. Think about that. A lot of engineers in the room. I can take 100 Lidman stethoscopes and show you. Take them through their entire audio range, and they give me the exact, every single one of them give me the exact range in decibel levels from the softest murmur to the harshest murmur. And now I take 100 stethoscopes and I put it into 200 different ears. Let's deal with, somebody's testing to see if I hear that, I do. Question is what's between the ears. Folks, I used to pride myself. I ran a department of medicine. I ran a house staff program. I was in charge of all my senior faculty. Okay, I used to pride myself on trying to stay up to date. Folks, there is no way any physician can stay up to date. Do you ever wonder why there are more and more specialists? It's our protection. If we can get into the narrower area, there is a possibility we'll be able to embrace all the new information in that narrow area. It's gotten so bad that people are saying very soon, you know, we are going migrating. We know more and more about less and less until we know everything about nothing. Huh. And then there's the general practitioner who's trying to learn a little about everything until they know nothing about everything. The reality is there's no way we can keep up. And if in the question and answer period, if we have that time, I'll tell you a way we can do that. Well, what we need to do is bring collective expertise to the bedside. And when I worked with NASA, one of the things I was asked to do is speculate on how we were going to provide healthcare delivery for the 7 astronauts going to Mars. And that was under Golden's directorship. That was his target, Mars. So, of course, we all sat in a room down at NASA's Space Center down in Houston, and we said, okay, well, one of the astronauts of the 7 needs to be a physician. Oh, of course. That's easy. Well, wait a minute. What kind of physician? One hand, oh, well, it needs to be a urologist. A urologist? Yeah, because of all the microgravity and all the calcium that's going to be absorbed from the bone, they're going to be filtering a whole bunch of calcium. They're bound to get a kidney stone. And any of the men in the room who've ever had a kidney stone, I say men for a particular reason, because if you have had one, you know that the pain, the only thing comparable to that pain is giving birth. It's bad pain. Okay, so, oh, we need a urologist. No, 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 we don't need a urologist. We need an orthopod. The reason we need an orthopod is that, in fact, as soon as the commander of the space capsule sets foot on Mars, even though the gravity is a little less than Earth, that weight pressure on that absorbed calcium from the bone is going to cause an ankle fracture. We need an orthopod. No, no. Statistically, and I'm not going to go through the radiation biology, which is the real critical problem, there is